Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasambuddhassa. Buddhang dhammang sanghang namassami. So I recently started diving into a book called Buddha Dhamma by a well-known monk named P.A. Piyuto in Thailand. And I was first encouraged to read this book by Ajahn Pasanon and Ajahn Jayasaro. They said that if they were both trapped on a desert island, this is the one book they would bring. And I like to supplement this story by mentioning another monk, Ajahn Buddhadasa, who said that if he had to bring one book onto a desert island, it would be a necklace that said, "It's like this," which is really great. And this book is a compilation of different teachings from the suttas, the Buddha's dispensation. One list in it is the uses of appropriate attention or wise attention. In Pali, a term translated yoniso manasikara. And yoniso means, or it's etymologically related to yoni, the word for womb. And manas is intellect. Kara means action. So manasikara is action of the intellect or attention. And yoniso means attention directed at the heart of matters, at the essential aspects. But I think one can look deeper into that etymological implication of the term yoniso, because the Buddha was clear that the act of perception for a practitioner is not something that we can leave up to instinct or chance. Our perceptions and how we use them are effectively programs for how we see the world. And as practitioners, the world we see affects the heart we have. And the gaze we direct at the world gives birth, in a sense, to the world we live in. It was Hegel who said that evil lies in the gaze that sees evil all around it. And I think the same could be said for good. So attention in this sense is a womb as well, in that it is the birthplace of our world and also of our own hearts, because the world we live in shapes who we are. I tell the story of coming back to the US last year, and I fortunately arrived literally on election night and from Thailand. And found that even though the people I met in my life had had very little concrete change in their day-to-day existence, they still were surrounded by loving relationships, caring interactions, brightness, blessings. But they, in some sense, had lived or had come to live in a completely different world than when I'd left. And it was a world of headlines and fear. And not that there weren't things to be worried about or to act on, but they'd forgotten the bright garden that they used to live in. And it affected their hearts too. There was far more darkness and anger and aversion. And their worlds had changed, but they had also changed. So where we apply our attention shapes who we are. And it is not only the womb of our world, but it is also the world that we marry ourselves to. The act of perception in some teachings is compared to the signet finger, the ring finger. Because what you perceive marries you to a concept, it crystallizes. And our ability to change those perceptions consciously is not only a tool the Buddha gives us, but it is a duty that we take on when we decide to practice. Ajahn Siripanyo, when I came back to the US, said, look, you can, you know, look at the news now and again, but your job is that you can never let it give rise to even one unwholesome mind state. And the implication of that is any circumstance, when looked at with appropriate attention, can serve as a tool of brightening in the heart and of awakening. At the heart of it, we need a daily practice of mindfulness and meditation to anchor ourselves so that we can direct our attention. Otherwise, whatever we encounter, our own attention is just colored by it and grabbed by it, and we're swept along the tides of our own passions and aversions. This is compared frequently to shaking a bottle of water. The knowing quality in us and the impression become mixed like water and colored dye, so that all you have is a water bottle filled with red or green or various other colored liquid. And this is when you see the thing you want and immediately the mind becomes impassioned with it and focuses on the attractive aspects, or when you see the person you're angry at and the whole emotional sensation flares. And the mind that has become still is compared to the water bottle when it stops shaking, in that the clear knowing quality, the water, separates, and the dye or the oil, the objects that are known, separate, and the two become distinct. And when that happens, there's an autonomy that one gains and a freedom in that one can encounter any color, any substance, any impression, any interaction, and the mind remains clear and untouched, and it can direct itself intentionally towards the most skillful and meaningful and generous orientation towards that moment. And this is the gift we give our world when we learn to practice and settle and strengthen the heart, is even at that most basic level of perception, we can be bringing into being the world that is worth living in, and changing ourselves into people that walk in such a world and create it and give it to others. We learn to nurture that garden. The uses of appropriate attention that P.A. Piyuto outlines in Buddha Dhamma are looking at things in terms of their component parts, which means dividing them into more refined categories. which is much of what the Buddha's teaching does. The five aggregates, for example, are a way of dividing our focus of identity into the constituents of form, feeling, perception, of any moment of experience, into these refined details. And when that happens, an experience loses its power and its gravity, and we can interact with it in a more refined and careful way. So instead of walking into a room and, say, feeling self-conscious in a group of new people, you walk into the room and notice the form aspect, how the sensation feels in your body, how there's a knot in your stomach, how it knots in your throat. You notice the feeling aspect, the aversion that colors the whole experience. You notice perception, how those in the room suddenly don't seem like friends, but rather as people ready to judge you. You notice the sankhara, the volitional formation, what we term a program, say a whole constellation of bodily reactions and memories of other times you've walked into rooms and been self-conscious, and maybe this spirals into a whole set of narratives about how you're always like this and you can never just be relaxed in a group of new people. And consciousness, how even the most basic subjective experience of this has been deeply colored by all these other constituents. And because the Buddha gives us this ability to parse out an experience into such detail, it ceases to have its same power over us. And not only that, but we can alter it with a refined touch. You can relax that knot in your belly. You can question that memory and that perception of yourself as always this way and bring to mind things that were different, times that it wasn't like this. You can see the negative reaction. And suddenly, that whole crystallization dissolves. This is how we apply appropriate attention to analyze into component parts. The second was to look at things in terms of conditionality, seeing how this vortex of change we react to and are surrounded by is composed of many different conditions, things, interactions, people, circumstance, all mixing and bouncing off one another. And in a sense, many of us are echoes of this. Many of our programs and perceptions. And this allows one not only to see that the negative in one comes from a past of hurt. Usually almost any unwholesome mind state or habit can be traced back to an initiating wound. And that's where the compassion lies, in the doorway to compassion. Not just for ourselves, but for others. Knowing, as so often happens, when you understand what someone went through as a child, you completely understand what they're like now, or what they've been going through at home. And suddenly, the annoying coworker or the angry boss at work doesn't seem like a demon anymore, but just as a human, like you. The next is to analyze things in terms of the Four Noble Truths. The next to analyze them in terms of the three characteristics of suffering, impermanence, and not self. To analyze them in terms of Dharma principles and their purpose. And to analyze them in terms of the benefits, the drawbacks, and the escape of any experience. And I'd go into all of those, except that was what the last two talks were about, and we only have like half an hour. So let's come to the one that we haven't touched on, which is the next use of analyzing phenomena in terms of their true and false benefit. This parsing out means that we take a second and look more carefully at the perceptions and the criteria and the goals the world has given us, and separate out the craving and the extraneous aspects of those, and focus just on their real benefit to us, to our practice. So a car is just something that gets you around from point A to point B. It's not the Cadillac, which impresses the neighbors and lets you drive extremely quickly or get the partner you want. And in a sense, the entire multi-trillion dollar advertising industry is based against this specific act of appropriate attention. So we've got our work cut out for us. And there's a famous monk in Sri Lanka named Bhante Nyanananda who said that if you had to condense the whole of the Buddhist path down to one word in Pali, it would be Yavadeva, which in Pali means only for the sake of. And every morning and every evening, this is something the monks are supposed to do. We recite this before we eat. At monasteries, you recite it every day. You say, I take this food only for the sake of alleviating hunger. I use these robes only for the sake of warding off cold, wind, flies, mosquitoes, burning and creeping things, and for modesty. I use this lodging only for the sake of shielding from the elements, and I use this medicine only for the sake of keeping this body healthy. And what you're doing is you're watching how the mind's natural movement towards craving and desire colors the world around us. It invests it with far more than it deserves. Because the heart wants pleasure. It wants sustenance. It wants identity. It wants something. It's so hungry. And so it constantly flows out and looks for those around it. And at the same time, it creates what it looks for. So, because it wants excitement, it craves it. So we find ourselves surrounded by a world of objects that we're investing with color and enchanting ourselves with. And the term dispassion in Buddhism, viraga, literally means the fading of color. So this essentially means, you know, this is the process of becoming enamored with a new love. And they are perfect, and they are all you think about. And then they aren't. And if there's been no balance in that, then not only is the letdown brutal, but it's such an unkindness to another person to expect them to fulfill that image you're placing on them. What a tall order. And in a sense, it keeps you from feeling real love towards another, because real love consists of giving someone freedom and care just for who they are. And similarly, all these things in our lives which we invest with such meaning, the job, the career, the dream, they're all delicate and fragile. And if we see them and invest them with more gravity and meaning than they deserve, then we find ourselves chasing after each one and dedicating our lives to improving and getting the new iPhone or the new car or the new experience, the better relationship, perfecting everything in a world that cannot be perfected. So can we instead put that down and think of the world as only for the sake of, Yavadeva, good enough, for. And the missing ingredient here is so often only for the sake of what? only good enough for what? And this is where the ideal of awakening and the path come to be. Because so much of Western society's confusion and convolution and consumption and greed is based on the fact that because there is no spiritual ideal held clearly and a path laid to that ideal by society, the heart which wants nothing more than that transcendent ideal has nowhere to pour itself but into this world of shifting, fragile circumstance, relationship, and experience and material consumption surrounding it, instead of finding one stream bed deep enough for the whole of its being, it is forced to fracture itself into 1,000 turbulent streams towards this and that. And I remember this sensation very clearly in college when my life was fairly good, but I hadn't aligned my life with the Dhamma in the way that I knew I needed to. I wasn't living a life worthy of my death. And so I'd be pretty good for about 4 days of the week, and then I'd find myself at a movie theater binging on 4 movies in a row, even if the only thing was on was like a rerun of the Titanic that they'd started again, which I hadn't seen. It was actually a pretty good movie. But, and this is pretty mild, but you can see how this process accumulates, and you find yourself just fracturing yourself into this and that, and even falling in love at the time and investing someone with that same hope for what they could give me, and they never could, because I was applying the false benefit to them. I was looking to them for fulfillment. And all the romantic comedies, all the Hugh Grant movies, all this, in some sense, it's not our fault that we get fooled. We can't help but look to these things for more than they can provide. So can we instead set our sights on a transcendent ideal of awakening and know that that's the one place that our heart can ever be satisfied, is moving towards that? And then all the shifting and fragile and imperfect circumstances of our lives and all the imperfect, beautiful people we live with are okay, are enough. Then your partner doesn't have to fulfill you in every way. If they're enough of a support for your practice, if you're caring for each other, if you're good to each other, you may not be perfect. It's almost, the odds make it of who you're going to meet in the world mean you almost certainly are not with the perfect person or the right person in a certain sense. The odds just statistically are like that. But in a sense, they can be exactly right if one remembers that we're just here to care for each other as we progress along the path to bring out the best. And I remember this scene when I was a layman. I watched Fiddler on the Roof, and you know, just seeing how society was, not that arranged marriages are great things, but you could see how this couple was able to live together. Granted, it's a movie, but society did exist like this for a time. And how a couple was able to exist together because their hearts were set on, for them, what they would call God. And so seeing that the real benefit of our lives, of every experience, is just what it can provide in terms of our practice. And this can be even negative things, or what we think of as negative. If we look at the false benefit, then something's charge, its valence, is for us just to get away. But if we see that even negative experiences are a chance to grow, to really think of each challenging person in our life as a teacher. And I love that story of the Sufi teacher Gurdjieff outside of Paris, who ran a community where there was one very troublesome member who the others eventually chased out. And as soon as Gurdjieff found out, he scolded them and told them that he paid that man to be there so that they could all practice with someone they didn't like. And in a sense, this is the chance of seeing the real benefit of even those things, those challenging relationships. It's a chance to grow in love, in compassion, in care. Even our losses hide in them the splinter of Dhamma if we keep our sights on the right North Star. And this is also one of the beauties of the Buddha's wisdom. It's not just what he taught, but what he didn't teach. There's the famous story of him taking a handful of leaves and saying, "Bhikkhus, what is more, this handful of leaves are those in the Sal forest?" And the bhikkhus say, "Those in the forest." And the Buddha says, "Just so, that which I have known through direct knowledge is like these leaves in the forest. But that which I teach is just this, to suffering and the end of suffering, just this handful of leaves." And time and again, the Buddha put aside questions of the exact origin of the world, of exactly what the transcendent was in strict terms, of various cosmological rabbit holes. And in a sense, the last millennia of Western philosophy has literally been answering questions the Buddha said that you shouldn't try to answer. And if you walk into a modern art museum, there's use of art. But really, what a rabbit hole at some level. And this comes into very practical focus when you begin to piece together your practice, because there are many useful means in different traditions. Qigong is very used in many of our circles. Different conceptions of the breath, yoga. I write poetry. It helps my heart feel strong and cared for. But you see how so many of these traditions went off on long, millennia-long rabbit holes, tangents. And if you want to dive into Taoism to the point of trying to become, you know, long-lived to the point of 120 years, you know, this is one of the goals laid out in that system. And our practice can become a complete miscellany of mixed messages. So can we think of each thing as only for the sake of just enough? Can you bring in just enough of this practice with the body, with Qigong, that your mind and body can settle down into samadhi? And then can you apply that calm just enough to insight? What's leading to wholesome states, and what's leading to that sense of fracturing and dead ends? And when you find discontent or doubt plaguing you about a relationship or a circumstance, I find that just enough recollection is very powerful. Not just, is this food enough for me to survive on? Are these clothes enough? And as monks, when we ordain, we're required to acknowledge that we must be content with no more than rag robes, with the root of a tree for shelter, with just rice for food. And this one always comes across strange in Western context, but fermented urine for medicine, that was a thing in the Buddha's time. And so this simplicity, and when you're worried about a relationship or something in your life, if you can say, is it enough? Is it okay enough for me to practice? It can take a huge load off the heart. And that's constantly our goal, is we don't just relieve all these things we've invested with color and passion and craving and aspiration. Even as they fade, something else we have to bolster and enchant ourselves with, in a sense, and that's the goal. We have to hold it up, direct the heart to it consciously, because only when that happens will the heart be willing to put down its craving and its chase after all these other things. Only then will it be able to see the real and false benefit of what's around us, to take off its rose-colored glasses. So this is where you find a spiritual community, where you step out of your life for a time and go on retreat, where you create a shrine or some image in your house you find inspiring and bow to it every now and again. And if you can, every day. Because you're remembering what you align your life with. And you're remembering what everything in your life is for the sake of. And even our loves are just a means of reaching through relationship to a deeper love. Even our most carefully held companions and spouses and boyfriends and girlfriends are just a means of touching something far greater, and they should be held as such. We are conduits for each other to a deeper giving and purpose. The next use is of appropriate attention is to nurture wholesome dhammas in the mind. And this basically means bringing up wholesome mind states defined as the seven enlightenment factors, mindfulness, investigation of dhammas, energy, rapture, tranquility, calm, equanimity, and starving the negative mind factors, the five hindrances, sensual lust, aversion, drowsiness, restlessness and remorse, and skeptical doubt. And there's a sutta called the Ahara Sutta in the Samyutta Nikaya, the connected discourses, where the Buddha spells out the exact means of starving and feeding each of these. And much of it comes down to when feeding these good qualities, in any experience, he tells us to give our attention to the sign of something, or frequently this is the case. So if we starve the hindrances by, if the hindrance is sensual desire, we give our attention to the sign of the unattractive in something. If our hindrance is aversion, we give our attention to the beautiful, to loving kindness. Sorry, to the beautiful. I mean to, yes, to loving kindness in this one. If our hindrance is sloth and torpor, we give our attention to brightness, to the potential for energy. And we don't give our attention to the sign of drowsiness, boredom, and I believe yawning after the meal, or something like that is the term in the suttas. If our hindrance is restlessness and remorse, we give attention to themes of stillness, calm. And if our hindrance is skeptical doubt, we give our attention to bright and dark states. That last one is confusing, but I think it's very interesting because what it implies is that when doubt comes, you stop looking at the object of the doubt, the decision that you're trying to make, which you never make when you're in that place, and you turn your attention instead to the mind state itself and see its quality. Is it a dark, agitated state of doubt? Just feel that. Turn your attention towards that quality of doubt, the doubting mind. And when that dissolves, when you let go of that, then the issue resolves itself. And similarly with bright states, we cultivate perceptions of energy, of calm, of various things. And it's interesting because in speaking of how to feed the enlightenment factors, the Buddha is actually somewhat vague, except when it comes to how we cultivate investigation of the mind, investigation of dhammas, in which he says, as with doubt, one should investigate bright and dark states, states connected with the good and with the dark. And what I take that to mean is that this is permission and encouragement to apply that enlightenment factor of investigation to every other enlightenment factor on that list. You have to see what works for you. How do you cultivate bright states in each of these moments? How do you arouse energy for yourself? How do you bring the mind to calm? And you only know that by repeatedly seeing how your mind is affected by different acts of attention, by what you give your eyes to, your gaze to. So we kind of have to think like a thief, in the words of Ajahn to Nisabho, and figure out our practice little by little in this way. And sometimes this can be very simple, but it's something we constantly have to work at, is cultivating these wholesome states in the mind. And any circumstance can give rise to those wholesome states. So our task is, whenever we find ourselves falling into aversion or this or that, what way of applying attention in that moment is completely wholesome? Because there's always a way. One place people frequently encounter this is aversion. Because aversion can exist in our lives as a low-level hum constantly. You know, we're always kind of chewing over that same argument, the same thing at work. We wake up and the vision of that person's face is the first thing we see and crystallize around. So how do you apply attention in that moment to cultivate the good? Or even with a really difficult circumstance? Maybe you bring to mind three good qualities about the person and really think of those. Maybe you take a moment and think about the goodness in the person, or the conditions that gave rise to that person's particular neuroses and challenges. What in their childhood wounded them? Maybe you look towards their suffering. Maybe you divide them into those component parts and just see them as a mixture of a body, feelings, consciousness, just all working together, trying to not suffer. With certain political leaders you might not agree with, can you look to their own suffering? And you'll notice that a lot of these means of cultivating wholesome states rely on the other uses of appropriate attention, analyzing into component parts, looking at things in terms of their conditionality, looking at them in terms of the Four Noble Truths. Even something like the decay of a relationship or a city or a body, you can look at in terms of the three characteristics of impermanence, not self, and suffering. And when you do that, even that becomes a means towards letting go of our white-knuckled grip on the fragile, on the changeable. It can be a means of stopping looking for refuge and nourishment from that which cannot reliably provide it. And this doesn't mean we come to this blank state of detachment. Rather, it means we learn more and more to cultivate an inner wealth, a goodness that we give to others. And we stop moving into the world with the intention to feed, and rather with the intention to give. Looking at things in terms of their decay allows us to see through the veil of the world to what lies deeper than the world. So it's a gift. Who's ever lamented the veil's dropping for the face it revealed? The next use of appropriate attention is to stay in the present moment. And this is very much held up in modern meditation circles, and that's good. The Buddha speaks of it explicitly in the suttas only in the context of death meditation, bringing to mind the fact that you will die and you don't know when, and it might be very soon. And instead of this giving rise to a dark state, and if it is, then you should pull back from this meditation or this recollection. But what it should do, what it's meant to do, if done skillfully, is remind you that every moment is absolutely precious and rare. And when monks came to the monastery, or people to the monastery, not sure if they wanted to ordain, this is always the instruction my teacher would give them, is recollect death every day. Because after a time, all those excuses about putting off what you know you should do fall, And suddenly, so many of the things you thought were important no longer seem so. And it doesn't mean you necessarily take robes, because not everyone's going to be monastic. But it does mean that little by little, we winnow the chaff of our lives from the grain. And you realize that it is just not worth it to yell at your roommate over the unwashed dishes, because you're both going to die, and it might be tonight. And if it's not tonight, at some point you will both be dead. So can you instead use the moment for love? And the other way of keeping in the present moment is to cultivate the four foundations of mindfulness. And this is what meditation helps so much with, is we learn to maintain careful awareness of the breath. And you can check in with it throughout the day. During your job, can you fit in little 10 seconds breaks of just coming back to center, of closing your eyes at the computer, putting your hands in your lap and just meditating? Or if you link those moments to certain tasks, if you work at a restaurant, whenever you go to fill up a soft drink for a customer, can you stop and take two breaths before you fill it? Can you set your alarm to sort of buzz and remind you to take a second? Can you use 10 minutes of your lunch break to meditate? There's a great disciple in Thailand of my teacher who, for his half an hour lunch break every day, he'd put a sign on his door that said, "Do not disturb, meditating." And his co-workers thought he was pretty weird at first, but eventually they began to respect the space and give it to him. And we learn to become sensitive to our feelings and remain with them and our mind states. But the body is our most robust anchor. Can you come into your feet? Can you just be with that sense of your solidity at the soles of your feet on the ground? Can you feel how your breath becomes charged? This is your thread to the present moment so often. But what's very helpful to remember also is the fourth foundation of mindfulness, of negative and bright states of dhammas. And that when something drags you away from that state of attention to the present moment bodily experience, another way of applying mindfulness is just to see what it is that's dragging you away. What's the hindrance? Ayah Ananda Bodhi says that for her first years of practicing mindfulness of breathing, most of the time it ended up just being mindfulness of mind, and I would also say mindfulness of dhammas, in the sense of just seeing what's dragging you away again and again. Because a meditation that fails to become calm is not a failed meditation. If you just see which particular neuroses you're most prone to and what's has you in its grip, that is a great insight. And sometimes that's all it takes is just, you can't be with the breath, but you can just acknowledge this is sensual desire, and this is how it feels, and this is how it hurts, and this is how it feels like I'm wasting my time, and this small pattern I'm seeing in my sit is what is dominating my life. And that's an insight. It's not a wasted sit. So that's another way of staying in the present moment that gets overlooked, is seeing what's dragging you away from the present moment. Which is a little confusing, but it works. And the final use of appropriate attention, I think we actually going to move through them all today, is to look at things in terms, or using appropriate attention in the service of analytical conversation. And this is actually an epithet for the Buddha's teachings as a whole, vibhajavada. Vibhaja means to separate, to make distinctions. And vada means a saying or speech. So the whole of the Buddhist dispensation is a way of conversing, in a sense. And the more you look to this teaching, the more you realize that it's different than so many religions in the world, in that it is not an overarching, or not chiefly, an overarching system of cosmology. It is a very careful training for the mind and heart. And of the 22,000 pages in the Buddha's canon, of those years he spent teaching after enlightenment, you go through them and there's nothing like it on earth. A body of text that large, completely dedicated to giving you practical means towards awakening. How do you train your mind? How do you purify your heart? And a large part of such conversation is seeing what questions you don't need to ask. And I love the fact that in the suttas, even the enlightened beings still love to get together and talk about the Dhamma. It's like, what do they have to talk about? They're enlightened, and yet there's such joy in it. And I find that's true, is every time we were at the... This morning, many of us were talking about this aspect of recognition that is so threaded through the experience of coming to Buddhism, to the practice of just recognizing these people that you've never met and just feeling like you've known each other for a long time, of hearing these teachings and knowing it's deep. One person among us was talking about her first moment reading a Thich Nhat Hanh book and just starting to cry. And another member gave out the book, What the Buddha Taught, which happened to be the first book that Ajahn Sumedho read when he was in the Navy. And he recounts reading the first page and being like, well, I'm a Buddhist. And in the suttas, that's always what the people say when there's a teaching that they get, is they say, it's as if you've uncovered something that had been covered, turned upright what had been turned upside down. And all those images have to do with recognizing something we know. This conversation, this whole path, this teaching is just about steering ourselves back home. And this, in a sense, is the depth and the power of this attention which creates a world, is that we're finding our way back to Eden, in a sense, towards awakening. And that's the world we're giving birth to. And that world gives birth to us in our hearts. So I wish you all the best in that path. Got through all 11. Well done. Do people have, we have a little bit, maybe time for one or maybe two questions if people want to speak on anything particular? Steve.
There's a sutta.
Thank you. The question was, there's a sutta where the Buddha speaks about the danger in the future of teachers expounding the Dhamma in beautiful language and poetry, or particularly people becoming enamored with such teachings and forgetting the real discourses and the real teaching because they get enamored with the words of poets. And Steve was saying, how do you navigate that? Because, you know, he sees people bringing into the teachings different poems, but sometimes it really does seem to move off into the periphery and down rabbit holes, and how do you maintain? And that's why he comes to the suttas again and again, but how do you navigate that? Yeah, Ajahn Tanisro says that the poet laureates of the Buddhist tradition have quickly become Mary Oliver and Rumi. I love Mary Oliver and Rumi, but it's a good point in a certain sense, in that I mean, first of all, the Buddha did have, there was a lot of poetry in the Buddhist canon. And in a sense, if you read the Tarigata and the Tarigata, the elder verses of the verses of the elder nuns and monks, it's kind of the first body of nature literature, nature poetry, ever really written in the world, because it was all these royal, classically trained aristocracy in India who were heading off into the forest, and it's filled with poetry. And most of the earliest Buddhist discourses, like the Sutta Nipata, they're in poetic form as well. But yeah, you know, when does that become a rabbit hole? And I'd say that is a balancing act, but it's the importance of that daily reflection of Yava Deva, only for the sake of. And I'd say that's, you know, people sort of read through the Pali Canon and it seems like a lot of lists and somewhat dry to many, most at first. But what the Buddha was doing so carefully was he wasn't trying to create a rosy teaching that would enchant his listeners right away in that sense. He was creating a clear framework with that would outlast the rise and fall of empires. He was creating a very clear seed that would last millennia. And I think that was part of his restraint around articulating the transcendent as well, about Nibbana. I mean, he points his hat to it, but he doesn't say much about what it is. But what he left us with was this concise seed, this landmark, this clear map. And I think he trusted that wherever you planted that, the various expressions of beauty would rise up on their own. You see that in every culture. You have Zen art, you have statues, you have Tibetan mandalas. Like, every culture creates their proliferation of flowers from the Buddha's teaching. But I think he realized that if you give the world a flower, it fades in a season. If you give it a seed, it lasts for millennia. And so yeah, coming back to the suttas again and again, and it's okay to go off a little bit and bring in other things in support of that, but you need your landmark. And the Buddha's restraint in giving us that is astounding. And it's the reason that the Buddhist lineage of monastics and the Sangha, it's the oldest institution on earth, apart from the Jains, who beat us by like 5 years. So yeah. So it's definitely something to navigate. And I do, there's one Mary Oliver poem I reference frequently, but I think a sutta-based approach is important. Those lists are really useful, and they sink into your mind deeper and deeper, but it's also the importance of pulling back from a lot of the entertainment. The lists aren't that exciting if you've been watching Avengers for like the last month, you know? You gotta get a little more refined, and then those things begin to grow in you and you really see the power of that wisdom. So yeah, I'd say he gave us the seed less than the flower sometimes, even though there's a great flowering there, even in your own heart over a life of practice. But it's very concise and systematic.